Welcome to Module 6 of Point Set Topology course. Today, at last, we will start the definition of topological spaces and some few examples. Before that, let us motivate this definition by studying one important aspect of same thing in metric spaces. Okay, so this is, I have put it as a theorem. You can say it is just surmising what is happening in metric spaces. Let XT be a metric space. Put tau D, this is a collection of subsets of X, U contained inside X, such that U is union of balls, open balls, B, R, I, X, I, remember, are open balls with centered xi and radius ri. So I put union of that. I don't know how many I have taken here. That is why I have ui. Okay, it could be finite, could be infinite, it could be uncountable, whatever it is. It could be empty also. When it is empty, what is the union of empty? Empty set is empty set. So it's also allowed. So take all subsets U, which can be written as union of balls. So that is my TAD. Okay. Then this satisfies the following properties. First thing is, just now I told you empty set is there because you can take empty union. X is also there after all. Why? Because once any point X belongs to X, okay, it will belong to some open ball. And then that open ball will be there, right? So, so you can take a union of all open balls around each point that will cover the whole of X. Therefore, X can be written as union of balls like this. So X is there, right? If you take a subfamily of tau D, any subfamily, okay, then the union of that subfamily will be also in tau D. Okay, the third thing, which is very simple minded but very important, most important one, if two of them are there, tau D, then the intersection is there. Once this is true, it will follow that if finitely many of them are there, then their intersection is also there. So from 2 to 3, 3 to 4, any finite number we can get. So these are the fundamental properties. I have just collected them. I can collect a number of them, lots of them. But these are the things which I am concentrating. Just like we started with modulus and took three important properties, right? We took, made it into a norm. Similarly, three important properties were made it into metric and so on. So, along with the same theme, we have taken these three important properties. So, let us first test them. These are going to be axioms finally. Okay. So, let us call the members of TD as open sets. This is just a tentative definition. Soon, we are going to change the definition of open set. Right now, let us call them as open sets. Okay, it is not the same thing as open balls. Open balls are defined in a different way. Now, an open set means union of open balls. Okay, let us call them as open sets. The theorem says that the whole space and empty set are open. Arbitrary union of open sets is open. And finite intersection open sets is open. Okay. Given a subfamily, one part I have already explained to you, part one. I have already explained to you why this happens. givenness of family, when you take the union of over all of them, right? Union of U alphas, each of them is a union, so you can write it like this. Union over union is just a union. With a, it's like a double summation, right? Wherein, in the case of numbers, you will have to bother about whether it is convergent and so on. Here there is no question of convergence. Double summation, whichever way you want to take, you can sum it up. It is like a union of sets. Okay, that verifies too. The third one requires a little bit of analysis. What is this? Namely, you have to use the property of the distance function appropriately. Okay. So take a member here. Okay. Take a member here, U1 and U2. They are themselves union of open balls. When you intersect them, what is it? That is a union of intersection of one ball here and one ball there. One ball here, one ball there. All pairs of intersections you have to take. Some of them may be empty, some of them non-empty. But it's a union, okay, intersection of the union something is union of the intersection. That's what I am going to use. Therefore, it is enough to prove that intersection of just two of them, okay, two of the balls now, is again a member like this. It's a union of balls. See, first I have to prove that intersection of U1 and U2, where U1 and U2 are arbitrary open sets like this, unions like this, intersection is open. But that will convert it into just proving the intersection of only two members, namely how they are themselves balls now. U1 is BR works and U2 is BS. So I show that this intersection is a member of TD, then the union of all these will be the arbitrary intersection. So that will be also there. Okay. So if U1 is BR of X and U2 is BS of X, Z belongs to the intersection would imply both DZX and DZY are this is less than R, that's less than S. That is the meaning of this, right? Z is in this ball means this one. Z is in this ball means this one. Right? Now what is that I'm going to look at here? Look at this one. This is a ball of radius R. That is a ball of radius S around Y. Now Z is taken in the intersection. You can see that the intersection is not a ball. Okay. Here it is a lens, it's a lens-like thing. All right, but it will contain a small ball around Z. For each point, contains ball. So it itself will be union. What is that ball? You have to choose this radius appropriately. If the distance from X to Z is A, and the radius is R, whatever is left out here is precisely R minus A. So I can take as big as R minus A. But I have to worry about the other one also. So here, radius is S and distance is B. So I have to take at the most S minus B. Therefore, I have to take the minimum of the two. So I take the minimum of the two, then I am done. That's a positive number. And that ball will be contained inside both of them. Okay, so that is precisely what I have done here. A is dz of x, b is dz y, and epsilon z is minimum of r minus and s minus b. All right, then if p is inside this ball, you have to use triangle inequality. Distance between this and this, okay, is less than this number, will imply the distance between here to there, which is A plus distance here, that will be less than R. Similarly, the other one. So that's what happened. P belongs to B epsilon Z implies dzp is less than epsilon z. But epsilon z is minimum of r minus a and s minus b, so it's less than r minus a. So I can write here, if you take exactly minimum, less than or equal to, correctly, to be sure. Doesn't matter. Less than equal to is good enough. Implies bpz, okay, actually less than z, because here itself I am taking less than. So this epsilon, but this may be equality here, but this is less than, that's correct. P dpz plus dz, this one, I am replacing r by this one, taking a on this side, so less than r. When you take a on this side, that's less than r. So dpr is, dpx is less than r. So p is inside br. Similarly, p will be also in bs of x. Therefore, it's the intersection. Therefore, so finally, this is what is intersection of these two balls is union of all these b epsilon z. This epsilon z will depend upon z. Okay, take them all inside in the intersection, so it will cover the whole thing. Okay, so this union is one, so that will be inside TD. Okay. So now the whole idea of proving this one is, we have these three axioms here. They become axioms here for a topology. Okay. So let's take any set X. Take the power set X. Okay. Take a family tau of subsets of X, that is a subset of PX itself. This will be called a topology on X if it satisfies the three axioms, which I have denoted by now, T, AU, and FI. X and empty set are inside tau. That corresponds to the first one there. The AU is arbitrary union. If F is a subfamily of tau, take all members in F, then take the union, that will be also in tau. If F is a finite subfamily of tau, take the intersection over this finite family, that will be also in tau. Instead of writing u1, u2, un, I have just written F is a finite subfamily. Okay, so these three axioms are there now. A set X, together with a topology tau, will be called a topological space. Logically, we should write, just like we write x comma d for a metric space, you should write x comma tau for a topological space. However, in practice, we will cut down the notation, just like in the case of metric spaces or non-linear spaces and so on. We may merely say that x is a topological space when the tau is understood. If we are discussing two different topologies on the same set X, okay, then definitely we'll write it. Sometimes there may be a different topology on a different set and so on. That on those things you should write. Otherwise, we need not write. Writing is not a crime. Only keep writing it, it takes more time and more space itself. Somehow, when there are two of them, you have to write which topology. Okay. So let us continue with the definitions. Elements of tau are called now open sets in X tau, or merely open sets in X. When you say open set in X, we mean the topology is already understood, it is behind. Okay. In particular, axiom 1 says X and phi are open. Okay, in every topological space. All right. Next, we will make a definition. A subset is closed if and only if it's complement. Sometimes I write complement for XC, FC. I prefer to use this longer definition, longer notation, X minus F. By the way, this, you can read it as minus F, but don't confuse it with the additivity of our real numbers or complex numbers. It is not a minus of that. So should not write the horizontal minus here. So this septuagetic minus is the correct thing. Okay. If the complement of f is open, then you call f closed set. Okay, complement of an open set is closed. Complement of a closed set is open by De Morgan law, that's all. Clearly, knowing all closed sets is the same thing as knowing all open sets. If you know all the closed sets, you know the complement also, that's all. Often, using De Morgan's law, a statement about open sets can be converted into an equivalent statement about closed sets. Okay, you have to do that in circus sometimes. However, geometrically, open and closed sets play different roles. Different roles. Okay. So in our mindset, there is something about, you know, almost as if open sets are more important. But logically, there is no difference. You must see that. Okay. Let X tau be any topological space now. I am continuing with the definitions. A subset is called a neighborhood of a point. The point is also inside X, of course. If there exists an open set U such that X is inside U and U is inside A. Okay, this is a definition of general neighborhood. Okay, I'm going to write NBD. This nomenclature for neighborhood. We shall use the term open neighborhood, that's ONBD, when A itself is open. A is open and X belongs to A, then A will be an open neighborhood of X. So this is the terminology. Okay. It's fairly easy to see that a subset A is open if and only if it is the neighborhood of every point belonging to it. So I will let you think about this one. Okay. In the second part, I am not assuming open neighborhood, just a neighborhood. Yet, if it happens for every open set, every point, you know, it's neighborhood of every point inside A, then A must be open. And conversely, converse is obvious. If A is open, it's a neighborhood, it's actually open neighborhood. Okay? If you know enough set theory, you may derive the first axiom T from AU and FI. AU is arbitrary union and FI is finite intersection. Hence, putting this condition is somewhat redundant. And some books do that. They don't put it at all. They just put only two axioms. And others put it four axioms by cutting T itself into two. Okay, so basically axioms are important, which are the only AU and FI. So we have included it for the sake of clarity instead of being too terse, though logically only these two are sufficient. And by the way, there is a general understanding that a definition should be as short as you please. As it can be. Okay. No extraneous explanations, terms, etc. should be there. This is the guiding principle of making a definition. Okay. If you follow that, this T has no value. The T should be removed because that is a consequence of AU and FI. Also, not so obvious is the fact that intersection over an empty family is the whole set. So this gives you, at least the beginner, some problem. Okay, so I want you to think about it. This is a very important thing. If you proceed further and further in topology as well as in mathematics elsewhere, this becomes a necessity to understand this one. Okay, so make a beginning. While dealing with topological spaces, you often have to use these facts, namely that a empty union is what? Empty union is empty set. Empty intersection is the whole set. So our topology was, after all, motivated by metric spaces. So there is no wonder if metric spaces give you, you know, a big source of topological spaces. How start with any metric space and this take this tau d, that is a topology. That is what the previous theorem says, right? 1, 2, 3 properties you have proved, and they are, those properties have become axioms, that's all. So x comma tau d is a topological space associated with the metric d. Right? So such a metric, such a topology, we will call a metric topology. That is coming from a metric. Sometimes we say it is metrizable instead of saying which metric it gives you. There may be several metrics giving the same topology. So it is just given metrizable topology. Okay, obviously there is going to be more, you know, stringent condition on a topology being a metrizable, right? There are some small class of topological spaces. The once you have created this definition, it's like a monster. Okay, it is no longer in our control. It will create lots and lots of topologies. Okay, so that is what I'm telling here. If you have only metric topologies all the time, then there was no need to make this definition at all. The fact is that the great people who worked all these things, harbingers of topology, had foreseen the floodgates that this definition opens up. Our next step is to study a few examples of topological spaces which do not arise naturally as metric spaces, topologies from metric spaces. But this we will do next time. Thank you.